Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. Elon Musk recently announced SpaceX's plans to be able to transport people anywhere around the world in under an hour, with most long-distance trips taking less than half hour using SpaceX's upcoming BFR rocket. Hold on. What? Anywhere on Earth in under an hour? That can't be possible, right? Well, today we're going to look into the feasibility as well as some of the challenges SpaceX will face trying to bring this concept to life. We're also going to do a quick look back in history to see what other once thought impossible modes of transportation are now a part of our everyday lives. So, will the average citizen really be getting on top of a rocket and traveling anywhere around the world in less than an hour? Let's find out.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff.
On September 29th, 2017, Elon Musk unveiled SpaceX's updated plans for their future rocket, the BFR, or Big Falcon Rocket. Now, despite this new version being smaller and more conservative than the version they announced just last year, there was one aspect that's widely criticized as being too far-fetched and impractical, using the BFR as a high-speed point-to-point transportation service here on Earth. So first off, let's do a really quick recap of what the BFR is in the first place. If you want to get more in depth, make sure and check out my video titled SpaceX's Crazy New Plans to Get to Mars, the Moon, and Anywhere on Earth. The BFR is SpaceX's next generation rocket and spaceship whose ultimate goal is to send humans to Mars to colonize it. Yes, that really is the primary mission. Some quick facts. Although it won't be the tallest rocket ever, coming in just behind the Saturn V moon rocket, it is still massively tall, standing at 106 meters or 347 feet tall. It's also not quite as wide as the Saturn V, but it maintains its massive 9-meter diameter from the bottom to the top, only tapering at the very tip. But the most record-breaking aspect will be thrust. The BFR will be powered by 31 methane-fueled Raptor engines, which can produce a whopping 53 meganewtons of thrust at sea level, which is more than the 35 meganewtons of thrust on the Saturn V. Scientifically speaking, that's a crap ton of thrust. That's enough power to lift 36 million bananas. The key aspect that makes the BFR even remotely viable as a point-to-point transportation service here on Earth is the fact that the first and the second stage of the vehicle are designed to be fully recoverable and rapidly reusable. The upper stage, or the spaceship portion, is sometimes called the BFS, or Big Falcon Ship, so we'll refer to the upper stage as the BFS from here on out. The BFS is designed to handle the heat of Mars' atmospheric entry, as well as Earth re-entry, and then it will land using a trio of Raptor engines to come to a soft and accurate tail-first touchdown. SpaceX will have a ton of practice launching and landing the BFR and the BFS, as they foresee using the upper stages as fuel tankers to rendezvous and dock with a nearly empty BFS. After the tanker refills the spacecraft, it'll land back on Earth. They might do this up to 5 times on some interplanetary missions. So they will have an awful lot of practice landing both stages of the BFR, and if they could manage to do this reliably, why not start putting humans on board? Well, let's address some of the issues. Let's talk about the feasibility of using a rocket as a transportation service. There's several factors that come into mind, including reliability, passenger health and safety, noise, economics, and the legality of flying a rocket to and from different countries around the world, landing near highly populated areas. First up, reliability. Can rockets really be reliable enough to be a viable form of mass transportation? One of the major design aspects of the space shuttle was to make it airliner-like, routine, and safe. As a matter of fact, after the first 4 flights of the space shuttle, crew on board forewent wearing pressurized spacesuits and instead wore essentially a pair of blue coveralls and a crash helmet. They did this right up until the space shuttle's 25th flight, when disaster struck with the loss of Space Shuttle Challenger and its 7 crew members. We're not going to get into why exactly the space shuttle ended up being unsafe in today's video, but I bring this up so we can reflect on the fact that NASA thought the space shuttle would be so safe, it would almost be airliner-like. But this doesn't reflect modern day, right? We've learned a lot since then, so let's take a look at SpaceX's track record on their current workhorse rocket, the Falcon 9. To date, the Falcon 9 has launched 43 times with 2 loss of vehicles, giving them a current success rate of 95.5% compared to the space shuttle's 98.5% success rate. Now, one could argue that in the case of the SpaceX failures, had there been humans on board, they probably would have been fine due to the presence of a launch abort system. But that's actually the kicker here. The BFR doesn't have a launch abort system, and second, in order for mass transportation to be considered a viable option, you can't go losing 4.5% of your rockets, or 1.5%, or heck, even 1 in 1,000 failure rate would be far too high. But at the pace of SpaceX's launch cadence, they clearly seem to be getting the reliability thing down, and I would love to see SpaceX hit 99% success with the Falcon 9 by 2020. Considering even in 1960, when airliners weren't nearly as reliable as they are today, there was still an impressive 99.995% success rate, or a failure just once every 20,000 flights. And although there isn't very good data from the very early days of airliners, it's still safe to assume that they were much more reliable than 99%. Elon reiterated how important safety is when he answered questions on a Reddit Ask Me Anything recently. He mentioned that safety will be especially important for point-to-point journeys on Earth. The advantage of getting somewhere in 30 minutes by rocket instead of 15 hours by plane will be negatively affected if, but also you might die, is on the ticket. That being said, there's still hope. For instance, take SpaceX's workhorse rocket engine, the Merlin 1D. Due to the high pressure and stresses, it's safe to assume that the rocket engine is the most dangerous and the least reliable part of rockets. Despite this, SpaceX has flown 435 Merlin engines and has only experienced one fail in flight, which was safely contained and the flight was still a success. That's getting pretty darn reliable. Not only this, the BFS will have three engines for landing, as opposed to the one engine that lands the Falcon 9. Also, despite the fact that the landing of the first stage of the Falcon 9 is still considered to be experimental, SpaceX has managed to land 14 in a row. It seems like now that they've got it figured out, it's a pretty reliable system of recovery. And the good news is that SpaceX continues to pick up its launch cadence, up from just two launches 5 years ago to hopefully 20 in 2017. They're even planning on 30 launches for 2018, and they show no signs of slowing down. Of course, this means they'll have many chances to learn from anomalies and design new reliability methods often. With airliners flying multiple times a day for several hours, there's troves of data to make aircraft safer, and now, hopefully, we'll begin to see more reliable rockets as the cadence picks up. Not only this, but since SpaceX has successfully recovered so many first stage boosters, they've been able to collect data and analyze their vehicle more than previously possible, which should lead to an even better and safer rocket. There's one more factor to keep in mind. That's the fact that SpaceX will be building the BFR from the ground up with full reusability in mind. This is different than current rockets that still share their heritage with expendable launch vehicles. They're currently made to be as light, high performance, and inexpensive as possible. The BFR overcomes some of these barriers with its sheer size, its massively efficient Raptor engines, as well as its advanced carbon fiber construction. One of the biggest issues with the space shuttle was having to inspect and replace the 20,548 different high temperature reusable surface insulation tiles that made up the heat shield on the underside of the shuttle. SpaceX's approach will be to mount the heat shield plates directly to the primary tank wall for simplicity and for being the most mass efficient method. This should make for refurbishment and servicing quicker and easier. Due to the fact that the BFS won't quite be getting up to orbital speeds on these suborbital point-to-point hops, the re-entry heating will be much less than that of the space shuttle, but it will still probably be pretty high and a major factor in the viability of this concept. Due to heat increasing by velocity cubed, not squared, it means if the vehicle comes in just 10% slower than that of orbital velocity, it would receive 25% less heat on re-entry. If you want to learn more about the effects of re-entry heating, I suggest you check out my video titled, Can SpaceX Reuse a Second Stage? So now, what about the logistics of passenger safety? Forget the reliability of the rocket, what are we going to do about having an 85-year-old grandparent experience 3 Gs of acceleration for 7 minutes, followed by 0 G for several minutes, followed by another 3 Gs of deacceleration? Forget puke bags, this thing's going to be a giant flying puke bucket. Well, perhaps there's something SpaceX can do to lower the G-forces and make the flight more enjoyable. In fact, Elon addressed this in a tweet stating, assuming max acceleration of 2 to 3 Gs, but in a comfortable direction. Will feel like a mild to moderate amusement park ride on ascent, and then smooth, peaceful, and silent in zero gravity for most of the trip until landing. Elon went on further to talk about how the landing portion will be as low as 1.3 Gs, which is the same as the initial launch. Since the BFR is capable of going into a high Earth orbit, it's safe to assume the BFR could still reach its destinations while throttling down the engines to provide a less punishing ride to space. Rockets experience gravity loss on ascent and when propulsively descending, so it is more efficient to accelerate quickly. But since these are suborbital hops, they won't require the full performance of the vehicle, and we could assume they can throttle down a little for passenger comfort. I speculate that unlike airlines today, there would need to be a rigorous health and background check in order to be a passenger on board a BFR. This is something that perhaps could be a yearly checkup and a yearly background check, but hopefully it wouldn't impede travel too much. It surely might weed out a few people, but I suspect rocket travel isn't for everyone in the first place. Speaking of impeding travel, one of the biggest points of criticism I've heard is the time it would take to board a boat, yeah, a boat, and then get all those passengers up on top of a rocket. Well, first off, I genuinely can't believe they didn't show using a Hyperloop instead of a boat. I mean, this is the future after all. If we factor check-in, security check, a 20 or 30 minute boat ride, an elevator, boarding, fueling, and all that, there could easily be 2 to 4 hours of pre-flight for the passengers. So some flights might not even make sense. But obviously, the payoff becomes greater and greater the further away your destination. While we're on the topic of boarding, how would passengers sit? My guess would be the seats will start upright and then they'll rotate back before launch, so passengers are on their backs. Like this. Maybe a little smoother than that. How far out would the launch and landing pad have to be from populated areas for the sound to not be an issue? Let's use the Saturn V as a reference, which was 91 decibels at 10 kilometers or 6 miles away. And considering the FAA defines significant noise as 65 decibels, we'd want these launch pads to be much further away than that. If the pads were 38 kilometers or 24 miles out, the launch would be a much less noticeable 79 decibels, but that's still pretty noisy. To get down closer to that 65 decibels, the launch pad would need to be nearly 160 kilometers or 100 miles away from populated areas. Hope they still aren't planning to get there by boat. If you've ever tried to catch a rocket launch in person, then you're probably familiar with the term scrub. When a launch gets delayed for any multitude of reasons, whether it be mechanical, range safety, or weather, the launch is scrubbed for its next available slot, which is often the following day or sometimes a few days later. This is something that will just take time to improve. For now, there's no way you could rely on a rocket launch to get you to an important meeting on the other side of the world. But with experience and time, hopefully scrubs will be a thing of the past. For instance, when SpaceX first started using super chilled propellant and oxygen, the industry poked fun at them, saying it's simply impossible to master and they're just wasting their time trying. At first, it seemed like everyone was right too. SpaceX would have scrub after scrub after scrub as they tried to perfect their prop loading procedures. As a casual or obsessed observer, this period of time was frustrating and almost scary. A lot of us fans wondered whether or not the others in the industry were right and that perhaps SpaceX was getting greedy trying to squeeze too much performance out of the Falcon 9. Well, fast forward to less than 2 years later and the Falcon 9 has been hitting every launch on time lately without fuss. No resets, no scrubs, nothing. Smooth sailing. Practice makes perfect, and with SpaceX launching more rockets than anyone, they certainly are getting better and better. Now, what about weather delays? One fun note is weather might actually be less of a challenge for rockets in some ways than it is for airliners. A rocket would only be in the atmosphere for a minute or two, and then from there on out, it'd be smooth sailing. So as long as the weather is good enough for launch, there should be no turbulence or weather issues during your travel. In fact, the Soyuz rocket can take off during storms, high winds, rain, and snow. Hopefully SpaceX will figure out how to make it so the BFR can take off in just about any situation that an airliner would be able to take off in. But we'll see. And although SpaceX isn't planning on using a launch abort system, they claim that they can get to airliner-like reliability and safety. This would be an absolute must if there's an absence of a launch abort system. It will probably take hundreds, if not thousands, of successful flights of the BFR before anyone considers it a viable form of mass transportation. But seeing how often SpaceX is launching, perhaps this will come sooner rather than later. So now we need to bring up cost. With the Falcon 9 currently costing around $60 million per launch, it's hard for us to picture a scenario where it'd be even remotely affordable, even for the richest people to fly in a rocket. But with a fully reusable system, the launch cost will eventually just be the cost of some fuel, some checkups, and occasional servicing, just like a jetliner. And luckily for future ticket holders, the methane fuel that powers the BFR is a lot cheaper than the RP-1 fuel used by the Falcon 9. According to Elon, he foresees the cost getting down to that of a full fare economy ticket on today's airliners. Although this seems very unlikely at this point in time, even if they can get it down to say $20,000 per ticket, they still might have a valid business case for the ultra rich. One more small detail, it's currently illegal to fly a rocket from one country to another due to rockets being able to quickly deliver nuclear weapons. But this could likely change if it's seriously pursued. And lastly, I think perhaps the biggest bonus is how many people would get to experience the overview effect. The overview effect is an awareness reported by some astronauts and cosmonauts during spaceflight, often while seeing the Earth from orbit or from the surface of the moon. It refers to the experience of witnessing with your own eyes the reality of Earth in space as a tiny and insignificant ball of life. From space, nations' borders disappear. the petty conflicts that divide people becomes less important, and the ultimate desire to unite all humans becomes apparent. To me, this unifying effect might be the most important reason we need the BFR. So, to summarize, I think it's best we take a quick look back at history. Once upon a time, only about 100 years ago, if you needed to travel from, say, Europe to New York, you'd have to hop on board an ocean liner, and 5 to 7 days later, you'd arrive at your destination. A first class ticket would cost around $50,000 US, with the cheapest tickets being around $172 in today's costs. Now, if you were on board one of these ships, and someone came up to you and said, in just 40 years, you'll be able to do the same trip in around 6 hours for about $500. You'd ask them, how much did you have to drink tonight? It would have been simply impossible to imagine a world where in just 40 years, the average person would be able to fly on a jet-powered airliner that would go across the Atlantic Ocean. Let's do this again with another moment in history. On October 14th, 1947, pilot Chuck Yeager climbed aboard his Bell X-1 rocket plane and broke through the sound barrier, something that most people thought was physically impossible. Now, despite this, in less than 30 years, you could purchase tickets on board the supersonic jetliner, the Concorde. And although the Concorde was forced into retirement due to rising costs and low passenger numbers, it does go to show how quickly we can go from something being impossible to something that anyone with enough money can experience in less than 30 years. Elon Musk seems to thrive off this type of naysaying. People laughed when he said he was going to launch a liquid fuel rocket into orbit. People laughed when he said he's going to dock with the International Space Station. I was there when SpaceX rolled out the first Falcon 9 with landing legs for mission CRS-3 in 2014. I heard the laughter of how silly it was to put landing legs on a rocket. People are laughing now when Elon says he can go anywhere around the world in less than an hour by putting people on top of the world's largest rocket. Well, I'm not a betting man, but if I were, I wouldn't bet against Elon Musk. So what do you think? Do you really think people will be boarding a rocket and getting anywhere around the world in under an hour? Take the poll and let me know your thoughts in the comments below. That being said, make sure you subscribe so you can join the discussion as we continue to learn more about the BFR. Also, remember, I live host SpaceX launches starting about 30 minutes before liftoff. So come ask questions and join the conversation live. And as always, a big, huge thank you to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other everyday astronaut content possible. I owe a special thanks to those of my patrons who are in the Discord channel who help me script and research. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Thank you. Don't forget to check out my web store for shirts, hats, prints, mugs, and lots of other fun stuff at everydayastronaut.com/shop. And as always, all the music in the background of my videos is original. Feel free to check it out and download it for free at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Tell a friend. Thanks, everybody. That does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.